Welcome. We are so glad that you could join us today as we commemorate June 19, 1865, better known as Juneteenth, the oldest day that we celebrate the end of slavery in the United States. But before we begin, we would like to open with prayer. Eternal God, you are Lord of this day, this moment in time, and we belong to you. We praise you for this fact and for all that flows from it on this day, when we are reminded yet again how good it is that although we are physically separated from each other, you who are Emmanuel are indeed with us. Thank you, God, our Father, for this commemorative experience that reminds us that there are still inequalities in our country. As we celebrate Juneteenth and what it meant over 156 years ago, we have to celebrate our ancestors and the life that they endured as enslaved people. Thank you for hearing the prayers of our ancestors and those who were empathetic to their plight. We pray that these yet to be United States of America would provide hope and equality for all people, regardless of their skin color, race, ethnicity, or religion. Give us hearts of love as we continue to speak up and speak out against inequalities that exist. We look to the cloud of witnesses that kept the faith, even in the midst of their lack of freedom and liberty and equality. So we stand on their shoulders and never give up, for there is still much work to be done. Let us always remember Juneteenth and what it meant to so many and continue to push for change and an end to systematic racism in our country. Finally, may we who profess faith in your Son, Jesus Christ, lift him up in every thought, plan, word, and deed. Lord Jesus, we exalt you in our lives. We ask that you guide us this day and every day to do what is pleasing to you. May all that we do glorify you. It is in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Juneteenth is an annual recognition of the moment when 250,000 enslaved Black Americans in Galveston, Texas were told that they were free in the year 1865. This was 2.5 years after the Emancipation Proclamation went into effect on January 1, 1863. I was born and grew up in Galveston. As a little girl, through all the way through my adult life, my family and community always celebrated Juneteenth. I recall parades with marching bands from Central High School. This was the all-Black high school in our town, and the band would march down the street and all the people would stand alongside and cheer them on to commemorate that great day. There are still unanswered questions of why it took 2.5 years for the news of Abraham Lincoln's emancipation to make it to Texas. Why did enslaved people continue living in bondage when the law said they were free? Well, there are so many theories about this. I used to ask my father this question when I was a little girl, and he said that it's possible that the messenger who was on his way to Texas with the news was murdered. And the other account, he said, could have been that the news of freedom was deliberately withheld by slave owners who didn't want to acknowledge it until the cotton harvest season had ended. Actually, I think the latter is probably the main reason. My family, like most families in our town, celebrated after the parade with backyard barbecue cookouts. We had our friends over and lots of family members. The backyard celebrations would start in the late afternoon because of the hot temperatures that existed in Texas in the month of June. There would be barbecue ribs and barbecue chicken, brisket, collard greens, macaroni and cheese, baked beans, watermelon, potato salad, and red soda water. That's right, soda water. In Texas, we don't say pop, we say soda water. And everybody drank red soda water on that day. The music would be playing from the radio, and we would all laugh and have a good time. The old people would tell stories of their youth, and the kids would run around and play. No one worked on that day. Everyone celebrated the meaning of Juneteenth. Remember, in my elementary school years, there was still desegregation in schools. There was desegregation on lunch counters, in bathrooms, and in most public places. We were free but not equal. Greater disparities existed then. I believe that is why most Texans celebrate Juneteenth in the 50s and 60s than today, because the inequalities were very much more overt and strongly enforced at that time. People were aware that we were not enslaved any longer, but we had not yet overcome. My fondest memories are of a combined Juneteenth and family reunion celebration at my grandparents' farm. My grandparents owned 100 acres of farmland in East Texas. They were never sharecroppers. They always owned the land, and it had been passed down through many generations of the Cotwright family. The people came from all over to our Juneteenth celebration that year. We were surrounded with family members and friends from local communities and from as far away as Houston, Texas. The men would play dominoes. Some of the adults would play spades. The kids ran around. We had the traditional foods that we ate and lots of music. It was such a fun celebration. And I still believe that in Galveston, Texas, people still celebrate Juneteenth in a similar manner. So I hope that you enjoy the Juneteenth celebration that the Montgomery County chapter of the Links will present to you today. And thank you very much for listening to my childhood experience with Juneteenth.
In 1949, Felton Hughes, a former slave at the age of 102 years old, was videotaped giving the history of what life was like as a slave. He talked about being sold as horse, cattle, with no regards to whether they were tired, if they had shoes or proper clothing. He said that he would rather die than to go back to being a slave. This was 160 years ago. We have to ask ourselves, where are we and where are we going? As people, we slowly picked up pieces and put one foot in front of the other to build strength. We are celebrating Juneteenth, also known as Emancipation Day. This celebration is more relevant now than ever, and there is much work to be done. We are the descendants of the links to this historic history. We must come together now more than ever and understand our why. Why do we fight to breathe? Why do we fight to vote? Why do we fight to receive equal education and access higher learning? Why do we fight to be given the same access to opportunities? We are at a disadvantage, but we know the path and we're going forward. We have to understand a few things first. We must never forget the sacrifices and lives lost so that you, I, and our children can have opportunities our ancestors could only fathom. Today, we must sift through the fray of convoluted argument and lofty wording to get back to the basics that we all well deserve. It is our duty as free and educated individuals to sift through the muck and pull out what connects us and not divide us. The definition of a link is a relationship between two things or situations, especially where one thing affects the other. This has become the cornerstone of Black Americans. With everything we do, we should understand that we carry the weight to this day. Nothing that we fight for and work so hard for to establish is in vain. We are an unbreakable chain, reinforced with a history that makes us stronger, wiser, and more solidified than ever before. As we listen to the gleam from our presenters today, remember and become invigorated for the work that must be done. We cannot grow weary in what we are doing. Our next generation will benefit from the fruits of our labor, and they will be blessed. We are the chosen, and our efforts count. Our service, our commitment, and our dollar, our voice count. I am so honored to be the president of the Montgomery County PA chapter of the Lynx Incorporated. Our chapter is honored to serve not only our community, but the nation as a whole. Again, I thank you for being with us today on this historic event, and I'd like you to sit back and know that you have to make a difference. Again, it is with honor that I introduce our Eastern Area Director, Shawana Tucker Sims. Before she comes on, I'd like to give you some information about this wonderful person. She lives by her motto, "To whom much is given, much is expected," and it is evident by her leadership and service and in personal and professional level. Professionally, she is Chief Talent Officer for the Connecticut Department of Education. Her education is from a bachelor's from Xavier, master's in public administration from LSU, PhD, University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. She is active in the community as a member of several organizations, including Life Member and Silver Star Member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Lifetime Member of Jack and Jill, and the Girlfriends Incorporated. In almost 25 years of LinkedIn, she has served in a variety of elected and appointed roles at the chapter, area, and national levels, including Chapter Facet Chair, Programming Coordinator, Recording Secretary, Vice President, and President. On the area level, she has served as Area Secretary and Area Vice Director. Ladies and gentlemen, Shawana Tucker Sims.
Good afternoon. To Kimberly Jeffries Leonard, National President of the Lynx Incorporated, Tina Coombs, President of the Montgomery County Chapter, officers, members, and guests of the Montgomery County Chapter, it is my privilege as Eastern Area Director to bring you greetings on behalf of the officers, leadership team, and over 4,500 members in 80 chapters of the Eastern Area of the Lynx Incorporated. I am delighted to be part of this joint celebration of Juneteenth and the 45th anniversary of the founding of the Montgomery County Chapter. In many ways, these important milestones reflect the spirit of our Eastern Area theme of embracing our legacy, cultivating our future. Juneteenth represents the legacy of our new beginning in the United States as people of the African diaspora. While the brutal conditions of slavery could not be erased with the delayed proclamation of its end, the announcement set into motion the journey for equity and opportunity that continues to this day. Embracing the fact that we were enslaved deepens our determination to maintain and utilize precious freedoms such as voting and education. Embracing the fact that they tried to erase our bonds to one another increases our commitment to sharing our history and strengthening our families and communities. Embracing the fact that we were treated less than human heightens our appreciation for our resilience, our brilliance, and our accomplishments. When the Montgomery County Chapter was founded 45 years ago, it started cultivating the future that our ancestors dreamed. I commend the chapter for the donation of your time, talents, and treasures through effective programming in all of our facet areas. From supporting food pantries to education in Jamaica, from a heart healthy social to rocking the vote and the census. This chapter understands the value of STEM in the future, with initiatives such as launching a Nesby Junior chapter, hosting STEM speakers, and even donating proceeds of today's event to the Black Doctors COVID-19 Consortium. Never has STEM been more important to our communities as we battle a global health crisis and grow increasingly dependent upon technology. I also want to thank you for sharing Colina Johnson Kemp in service to the Eastern Area Leadership Team as a member of the Area STEM Committee. Thank you, Colina, for your service, and kudos to the chapter for your passion for STEM. Keep fighting the good fight, Montgomery County. May you continue to be a source of caring, renewed strength, and enhanced quality of life for this community and for one another. Happy Juneteenth, and God bless.
Good afternoon, all, and let me take this moment to introduce our illustrious president, Dr. Kimberly Jeffries Leonard. Dr. Kimberly Jeffries Leonard has a lifelong commitment to public service exemplified throughout her successful professional, academic, and civic endeavors. Dr. Jeffries Leonard is currently the 17th national president of the Lynx Incorporated and the Lynx Foundation Incorporated. Dr. Leonard's extensive community service includes director at large at the American Cancer Society Center Action Network Incorporated, board of directors, vice president of administration, and member of the board of directors of the Black Women's Agenda Incorporated, member of the board of trustees at Fayetteville State University, member of the board of directors of the National Council of Negro Women Incorporated, and honorary chair of the NCNW, 59th convention, excuse me, member of the American Heart Association Diversity Leadership Committee, member of the PD Green Program Board of Trustees, life member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, and life member in Washington, D.C., associate member of Jack and Jill of America Incorporated, and ruling elder at 15th Street Presbyterian Church in Washington, D.C. A native of Fayetteville, North Carolina, Dr. Jeffries Leonard is married to D.C. FEMS Battalion Fire Chief retired Stephen V. Leonard, and they are the proud parents of two sons, Victor and Alexander. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Kimberly Jeffries Leonard.
Thank you, Madam President, for that lovely introduction. I am Kimberly Jeffries Leonard, and I am thrilled to be here with you today. President Forrestine Coombs, Montgomery County, Pennsylvania Chapter Officers and Chapter Members, Eastern Area Director Dr. Shawana Tucker Sims, Area and National Leadership Past and Present, Link members, including those in the Keystone Cluster, and guests, good afternoon and welcome to this Juneteenth commemoration. As one of the nation's oldest and largest women's volunteer service organizations, committed to enriching, sustaining, and ensuring the culture and economic survival of African Americans and other persons of African ancestry, it is my honor to bring you greetings today. My Montgomery County, Pennsylvania chapter sisters, our more than 16,000 members in 292 chapters located in 41 states, the District of Columbia, the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, and the United Kingdom, send their support for a successful event. To the Juneteenth 2021 Planning Committee, Forrestine Coombs, Wendy Brown, Crystal Jackson, Yolanda Turman, Marie Golson, Terry Brown, Walker Brown, Yvette Franklin, Colina Johnson Kemp, Vanessa Thomas Smith, Ann Tony Thomas, Roberta Terrain, Shannon George, Marie Pogue, Tyra Ford, and Dee Weston, congratulations on putting together an event that highlights a crucial part of our history as well as gives back to a wonderful cause. I join you in celebrating honoree Alice Stanford, founder and director of the Black Doctors COVID-19 Consortium. As members of the Lynx Incorporated, we are committed to alleviating the chronic health disparities that persist in Black communities and often result in a decreased life expectancy. During this pandemic, we emphasize programming aimed at helping our community navigate COVID-19. The work the Black Doctors COVID-19 Consortium is doing directly aligns with ours. Thank you, Mrs. Stanford. My Montgomery County, Pennsylvania chapter sisters, your selection of Ms. Stanford and the Black Doctors COVID-19 Consortium as a beneficiary underscores your commitment to transforming communities, fulfilling our purpose. And to do it on a day of such historical significance makes it even more amazing. As the oldest known celebration commemorating the abolition of slavery in the United States, Juneteenth is the day we rejoice in the resilience of our ancestors in the face of the atrocities they endured 156 years ago. It is a time that we celebrate how far we as a people of color have come. Though strides have been made, our work is nowhere near done. Many injustices still plague our world, including voting rights, police brutality, poverty and healthcare disparities, and we must be the ones to issue the clarion call of change. So, as we revel in the entertainment of the day, let us also be inspired to keep fighting for those currently in need and for generations yet unborn, and let us do so under the guidance of our ancestors. Thank you for commemorating Juneteenth. Let's never forget.
Bamba is both a traditional dance and musical style of Puerto Rico. Its origins are rooted in the island's history of African slavery, but today has evolved into a community expression of Puerto Rican culture. The movement and sound of Bamba fuses the practices of West Africans brought to the Caribbean island by European colonizers as slaves. It has, over time, absorbed influences from Spain, as well as the region's indigenous Taino people. I celebrate Juneteenth 2021 with a rendition of a Bamba dance that may have been done on the sugarcane plantations of Puerto Rico. Recently, the Bamba music has been heard at many Black Lives Matter protests, calling back to its roots as the music of resistance and resilience. Ashe.
Un Belén para Ismael, hay un Belén de bomba y plena, como le gustaba a él.
Un Belén para Cortijo, un Belén para Ismael, un Belén de bomba y plena, como le gustaba a él.
Mi homenaje le dedico a Cortijo, que la gloria escuchará.
Perico, que viene el tren.
Y allá vas a ver que Perico era sordo, yo.
age of 14, Isabella Hansen was inspired to launch a national poetry competition on Black Lives Matter. Sponsored by Gucci, Isabella's I Matter poetry contest drew participation from students in 26 states. The top poems and art were made into a compilation book honoring the lives of Black people killed by law enforcement in 2020. This project followed her 2020 Juneteenth celebration, which she hosted to bring racial healing to the community at the historic Fluellen House, a site that helped lead over 2,000 slaves to freedom. Isabella is an honor roll student at Kennett High School in Pennsylvania. She holds a leadership role in her school's diversity club and is a youth founder of the National Youth Foundation. She is a member of her school's track team, model UN team, and the humanitarian club. In her spare time, Isabella serves as an advisor for Lady Gaga's Born This Way Foundation and is a member of the Live Like Blaine Leadership Academy and Girl Gov. Isabella has also won over 10 grant awards for her work and has been featured on Nickelodeon's Kid of the Year program, as well as in Forbes magazine, Philadelphia Inquirer, and Medium.com.
Hi, I'm Isabella Hansen. I'm 15 years old, and I'm the founder of the I Matter Poetry Contest on Why Black Lives Matter. Today, I'm going to be reading the poem, Hey Google, by Cabrera Fisher Dunbar. Hey Google, what are some images of three Black teenagers? Oh no, I didn't mean mugshots. I meant Black teens laughing, hanging out with their friends, for recreational purposes, not selling drugs or stealing, just living their lives. Hey Google, where is a safe place for Black people to live? Yes, I need to know this information, even though everywhere should be a safe enough place. Why is the only place people think of as Africa, even though some people there hate us too? I wonder what we did. Did we offend anyone? Hey Google, how likely is it for a Black woman to die during childbirth? 2 to 6 times more likely than their white counterparts. That's high, don't you think? So what do we do if more of our mothers are dying? How do we repopulate? Oh, I forgot. They don't want us here, so they'll find any way to kill us off. Hey Google, what are some hairstyles for curly hair? Whoops, my bad. I forgot to add the Black girl after that. Is this hairstyle professional enough? Or do I have to straighten it again? Are my curls too much? Do I have to change my hair to prove my submission to your culture? Hey Google, what's the Black national anthem? Lift every voice and sing. We still have to sing because no one hears us. When singing turns to screams, are we still invisible? What do we do? As we are a shadow beneath thy hand, our problems get overlooked because we are the oppressed. The Black lives are equal to all lives, right? Hey Google, is it bad that I had to fight for my people? Hey Google, who is Breonna Taylor? Who is Ahmaud Arbery? Who is George Floyd? Hey Google, why are there so many names that I can't fit them all in one poem? Hey Google, why are Black children forced to grow up sooner? Hey Google, why do I have to be twice as better? Don't you know that I try my best and still get talked down on? Hey Google, why can't Black Lives Matter?
It is my pleasure to introduce Vernon Odom. Vernon Odom was with WPVI TV6 ABC in Philadelphia for more than 43 years. He joined the Action News team after working as an anchor, reporter, and talk show host for the ABC affiliate in Atlanta for 6 years. Vernon Odom's broadcasting experience dates back to the Martin Luther King assassination, when Vernon was a radio reporter in Atlanta. From there, he covered various phases of the civil rights movement in the South and the early political campaigns of such eventual national figures as Jimmy Carter, Andrew Young, Julian Bond, and Maynard Jackson. After graduating from Morehouse College in 1970, Vernon Odom did his postgraduate study in broadcast journalism at Columbia University. Since joining Action News in the spring of 1976, the list of major news stories he has covered is endless. All the presidential campaigns since 1976, the Three Mile Island disaster, the MOVE confrontations with Philadelphia police, the X-rated Clarence Thomas confirmation hearings, the triple X-rated Clinton Lewinsky White House scandal, the Los Angeles riots, and the O.J. Simpson trial. On the international level, Odom has reported from Latin America, Europe, and Africa, most notably the release of Nelson Mandela from prison and the unbanning of Mandela's African National Congress in 1990. Later, the first free election in South Africa in 1994, the U.S. invasion of Somalia in 1992, glasnost in the Soviet Union in 1986, the fall of the Soviet Empire in 1989, and the release of U.S. hostages from Beirut in 1991. Vernon was inducted into Broadcast Pioneers Hall of Fame in 2004. Odom's family history and journalism dates back to the 19th century. His maternal grandfather was the second African American to publish a daily newspaper. His sister Maida was a veteran reporter at the Philadelphia Inquirer. She recently retired as a full professor of journalism at Temple University and wrote for Reuters and nationally recognized newspapers, including the Boston Globe and the New York Times. Vernon is married to Wanda Motley, assistant dean of the Tyler School of Art at Temple University. They have two children and reside in Chester County.
Hi, Vernon. It's a pleasure. So, you are such an accomplished person. Can you just share a key or keys to your success to be in the media for decades? How did you sustain such a successful career?
Well, patience and hard work, I'd have to attribute it to. I studied hard. I started in radio when I was in college working in Atlanta. I was a student at Morehouse, and I was a radio reporter starting from about 68 on. And it was a tumultuous era and tumultuous time. I started actually in January, and that following April, Martin Luther King was assassinated, and Atlanta was a fascinating and extraordinary place to be. And I was right in the middle of a whole lot of things going on.
So Vernon, at the time, did you think you would stay in media for all of these years?
I was beginning to get hooked on it. I tell you, when Martin Luther King was assassinated, I was walking across Morehouse's campus, and somebody ran up and told me and a friend what was going on. And I told them, I said, you better get back to your dormitory. There's going to be trouble in this town and a whole lot of towns tonight. And I didn't know at the time he died. I was working as a radio reporter for about 4 months then. I hopped in my car, I went to my apartment off campus, and drove to Martin Luther King's house. He just lived a 5 minutes drive from Morehouse's campus. And I was driving down the road, and the riots had already broken out in Atlanta. There was already burning and looting and things like that in a place called Vine City, which was right on the other side of where King's house was. It was about a 5-6 minute drive, and I was driving down Sunset Avenue, which was the street that Dr. King lived on, and he and these blue lights start flashing behind me. I said, now why are the police going to bother me, man? They got trouble right over the hill here. And I was trying to get to the King's house, and they whizzed right around me. And it turns out it was the police chief of Atlanta, a man named Herbert T. Jenkins, and Mayor Ivan Allen was in another police car. And I said, oh my God, they're going to the King's house.
Something's wrong.
And yeah, and they were very progressive by Southern standards at that time. Atlanta was sort of an oasis for things. And when I got there, Mayor Allen went in, and about 10 minutes later, he came walking out with, and I could hear the police chief getting reports of rioting breaking out all over the city, burning, wow, looting, things like that. And about 10 minutes later, Coretta King and Mayor Allen came out. He was going to escort her to Memphis to find out.
Interesting.
And I had my tape recorder with me by that time, and I said, Mrs. King, what can you tell us? I'm so sorry to hear about this. And I knew her well. They lived around right 10 minutes away,
right,
and from the campus. And she said, well, Odom, she'd always called me Odom, you know. And she said, Andy just called me and told me that my husband has been shot. We don't know his condition. He's been rushed to the hospital. Andy, of course, was Andrew Young,
sure.
who was a King aide. I mean, around Atlanta, you called people by their
first name.
By their first names.
Well, except for you, Odom.
Yeah, right. And I said, hey, I hopped in my car and fought. And I got the first interview with Mrs. King, actually.
Wow.
Because she was coming out of the house to get in the
right.
police car to be rushed to the airport. Mary Ellen was going to accompany her to Memphis.
Interesting.
And I got in the police caravan to the airport, escorting her there. And I got there, and back in those days, it was way before hijackings, things like that. So I pulled my car right up to the curbside, and Mary Ellen got out and escorted Mrs. King in. And about 2 minutes later, Chief Jenkins had gone on to his other duties
sure.
because the town was blowing up.
My goodness.
And but I was waiting there for a few minutes, and suddenly Dr. and Mrs. King and Ivan Allen came walking back out of the plane terminal. And I said, that was an ominous sign. They weren't going to take that plane to Memphis. I said, Mrs. King, can you tell me what's happened? She said, my husband, Martin Luther King, is dead. Andy just called me and repaged me here at the airport. And Ralph was on the phone with him and trying to comfort me and things
Ralph
like
Abernathy.
That. Ralph Abernathy. You knew them all. I mean, they were local figures. They had churches. They lived there, and Atlanta was an oasis for them.
So, Vernon, it sounds like that experience with Dr. King's assassination and you being in Atlanta, that was really the pivotal moment, or one of them, that really started to shape this long-term career?
Yeah, I think so. I'd been working about 4 months as a newsman. I'd done some disc jockey work in Atlanta before that, but that really sort of got me plugged into it, and one thing led to another. And then when I graduated in 70, I went off to Columbia University to study broadcast journalism and things like that. So, and I've been, sometimes I think I'm just a masochist and want to make irreparable errors in life and stick with them, but I don't know.
So now, here we are, 2021. Over this past year, I'll call it the year of George Floyd, how does this past year compare to what you experienced when Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated?
Actually, you know, it's been deja vu all over again in many ways. I covered the presidential campaign of George Wallace and things like that. And, you know, his rallies were tumultuous with him race baiting and things like that. So when Trump comes along in 16, it's an instant replay of those things. So I've seen it all before. You know, I've seen everything, I think, now 5 or 6 times. But that was an instant replay. And as Yogi Berra would say, deja vu all over again. And so that started it off.
Do you think we've made some progress, though?
Oh, yeah. There's been enormous racial progress in many areas. But in many ways, we're in the same battle as we were coming out of slavery in 1865. Because there were a few years of Reconstruction, but then the Union troops were pulled out of the South and the Ku Klux Klan was formed. We were voting and things like that then. Now, all these decades later, we're fighting for our voting rights again, putting up with some Senator Bull Moose who's out to stop it. And in many ways, this is, when Lyndon Johnson signed the Civil Rights and the Voting Rights Bills back in the mid-60s, he said, we're gonna be having battles about this for the next many years. And it starts again as more and more black voters register. I mean, Trump is really just Barack Obama backlash. And while he won those two elections, he was elected then reelected, there were many, many people very upset and very angry about it. It was just squelched for the time. And but Trump is a result, in many respects, of anti-Obama backlash. So
sure.
we've had a terrible time. Police brutality's been going on. You mentioned George Floyd, but police brutality's been going on for dating back to the middle of the 19th century, and early 19th century.
So when you do a lot of reporting, have you really captured a lot of the resilience of African Americans that you've seen, and can you share some of that?
I like to say that, you know, if you go back through our history, it's been a struggle for us from day one. It's constant. Two steps forward, and they pull us back three steps in order to blunt any progress. As Julian Bond used to say, we're the who've never been treated fairly by you-know-who. And,
I love it.
And he meant that, and in a way it sums up things very quickly. Every bit of progress African Americans have made across the decades. The Ku Klux Klan emerges after blacks are actually elected to governorships in the South during Reconstruction. The Jim Crow laws are implemented. You have the Red Summers of in the early 1920s, where blacks are slaughtered in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and in dozens and dozens of other places around the country. And there's always been, the goalpost has always moved every time
Sure.
we take a step forward. So we're always, as Martin Luther King's father said, you know, we've been coming up on trouble for a long time. And a few steps forward, a few steps back. And it's a constant ongoing struggle, and we never seem to be able to get fully out of it.
So what would you say now to our youth?
Well, they need to study hard, stay in school, achieve, and take advantage of the educational opportunities that are
Absolutely.
Out here. And they are improving in many, many respects. Don't fall for all the demagoguery and things that go on now. Don't be embittered, but keep your eye on the prize and keep trying to move forward and capitalize and grow from where we've come so far in such a short period of time. It's amazing how well we've done considering the odds that have been against us all the way.
Absolutely.
We're an amazing and very resilient people, and we have much to be bitter about, and we have much to be and to be resentful, and it's all legitimate. And but you keep trying to capitalize because there's no place else for us to go. You know, the Civil War, that was not done for our benefit. Slavery would have been kept had they been able to keep the Union together. That's what Lincoln was really after.
Right.
And we've had a tough time, and we continue to have a tough time, but again, we're resilient. Look at all the achievements that black folks have managed to do and overcome and things like that. Look at right now, you have the young black doctor who helped develop the Moderna virus and was critical in that, and it goes on and on.
That's
and
right.
We've overcome a hell of a lot.
And we'll continue.
And we will continue. And but there's always a struggle. Benjamin Mays, the president emeritus of Morehouse, used
That's
to always
right.
say, the price of liberty is eternal vigilance. And you have to live with that, and I have to live under that code. Everybody who goes to Morehouse always learns that and goes that way. But you can't give up. You can't give in to bitterness or failure. You just keep on pushing as hard as you can. And it's been tough. It's been a struggle. You look at, now there's some black leadership, senior black leadership, begging some Senator Bull Moose to protect us our voting rights after we struggled for this all these years. But that was set in motion the day after Lyndon Johnson signed the voting rights laws in the mid-60s. There's been a movement afoot to try to kill it and make it resilient. That's where Justice Roberts, who's now the Supreme Court Justice, he was hired by Reagan in the Reagan administration to begin the process of overturning that. And we kept on pushing and kept on battling. And if you remember, and suddenly, oh my God, Barack Obama is the President of the United States, and he's running the military and he's running the government. That shocked and horrified a whole lot of people.
Well, and we see the results now.
See the results now, yeah.
That's right. Hey, Vernon, I just want to say we really, really appreciate your time.
Oh, please, anytime.
And thank you so much.
Thank you. Is that all you really need? If you want more, I can go on for hours. But you look at our struggle. People are suddenly, oh, my God, you mean there's police brutality out here? And when they saw the George Floyd video. Black folks have been screaming about that for years and years and years, and you know, they were telling us, it's just your imagination, you're seeing things, you're going to believe us or your lying eyes. And the cops have been getting away with that in the South and in big cities around the country for more than a century. And finally it was on tape, you saw the policeman murder a man right on TV, 9.5 minutes, and he was sitting there with his hands in his pockets and his shades on top of his head. And he saw the young lady videoing him, and so it was business as usual for him. And the first official police report said, well, he died during a struggle for the during the arrest. So, you know, we've been taking it on the chin.
And there's been many others, unfortunately.
Hundreds, if not thousands. And we've been taking it for the century on the chin ever since 1619. And many people would like that history to be ignored, you know, or to swept under the carpet. And it's just not going to happen anymore, you know, and that's the situation.
It takes people to stand up now.
Yeah, and keep on discovering what history, what's going on, what we've overcome, and what we've been up against for so long and so many in so many situations and systematically. Time after time and decade after decade, a few steps forward, they move the goalposts and try to pull us backwards, and many times succeeding.
And as Maya Angelou would say, and still I rise.
Right. And she also said, when people tell you who they are up front, that's who they are. Don't be fooled by false things. She said a lot of things which were quite defining and quite accurate, you know.
Well, thank you so much, Vernon.
My pleasure. Thank you for inviting me, and congratulations to the
Links. You'll be back again.
Okay, thank you. I hope so.
Okay.
Anytime I can help, just don't hesitate to let me know.
All right.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Josiah Yenem, and this video you are about to watch was created by me and my friends with the help of my parents. I would like to provide a little bit of background on this video. I was noticing a lot of division between the people of America, and I was thinking about what to do. Eventually, I came up with the idea to make a unity video. Over the course of the next month, I produced, recorded, and filmed a video of me covering Justin Bieber's Holy, featuring my friends, just to provide a ray of light and hope in this crazy time. I wrote a verse to emphasize the theme of unity, referencing the history of our country while visiting different historical areas of Philadelphia, including the President's House, the Liberty Bell, and Mother Bethel AME, founded by Bishop Richard Allen. I hope this video moves you, and I hope it provides at least the slightest bit of hope. Enjoy.
This is a moment I never saw in my life.
Leaving that business in tatters, we heard glass breaking elsewhere.
Sinners, don't think that I'll be a saint, but I might go down to the river, 'cause the way that the sky opens up when you touch it, it's making me say that the way you hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, feels so holy, holy, holy. Oh God, running to the altar like a track star, Can't wait another second, cause the way you hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, it feels so holy. I don't do well with the drama. And no, I can't stand it being fake. No, 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 no. I don't believe in nirvana. Cause the way that we love in the night gave me life, baby. I can't explain that the way you hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me. Feels so holy, 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 holy. Oh God, running to the altar like a track star. Can't wait another second, cause the way you hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, feels so holy. They say we're too youngin', the kids found the way, say don't go crushing. Wise men say fools rushing, but I don't know. They say we're too youngin', the kids found the way, say don't go crushing. Wise men say fools rushing, but I don't know. Say thanks to forefathers, and we all know it is great, but we have sinned, let's acknowledge. I'm a believer, my heart is fleshy, we the people made the constitution. Thomas Jeffy, no person perfect, check the reference, Henry Sally. But there's a difference between Assar and Truman Harry. Whoa, Democrats, Republicans, it might as well be sport. They still talking in your cap just to retort. Abort, gotta abort this mission, it's clear that something's missing. Malcolm and Martin lived it, and scripture it is written. Let's make sure we just listen, we say in God we trust. While people scraping stuff, me and that shit fuss. We were her work, applaud the brave. Money safe, but got made. It's all Christians, Buddhists, Muslims, the same. The rich can soon be poor, the half still want some more. But with your power, choose to open more doors. I know I ain't leaving you, and I know you ain't leaving us. America, let's stand together. I know God believes in us. Yeah, you hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me, hold me. Feel so holy, 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 holy. Oh, God.
Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for our Juneteenth celebration. Part of our funds today for this fundraiser will be given to the Black Doctors Consortium, or better known as the Black Doctors COVID. Started by Dr. Ayla Sanford, this group of healthcare professionals came together to address an unmet medical need.
education and empowerment for the African American community in the light of the coronavirus. African Americans make up approximately 12% of the population, yet we were making up 15% of the coronavirus deaths. Through the Black Doctors Consortium, Dr. Ayla Sanford and her team have vaccinated thousands of African Americans in the city of Philadelphia. We salute you, Dr. Ayla Sanford, and your Black Doctors Consortium. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Marie Golson, co-chair of the Art Basket for the Montgomery County, Pennsylvania chapter of the Links Incorporated and producer of this event. On behalf of our chapter and the Arts Basket members, I would like to thank you for supporting us. Juneteenth has been our chapter's signature event since 2003, and we are celebrating even during COVID. I'd like to thank all of our participants, our 17th National President of the Links Incorporated, Kimberly Jeffries Leonard, our Eastern Area Director of the Links Incorporated, Dr. Shawana Tucker Sims, our Montgomery County, Pennsylvania Chapter President, Tina Coombs, and my co-chair for the Arts Basket, Vanessa Thomas Smith. And I would like to give a special thank you to our featured guest, Vernon Odom. You speak the truth and you have the wisdom. I just want you to know there are thousands of people that have admired you through the years. You are not only a Morehouse man, you are truly a role model for many young men. Thank you for your participation. In addition, I'd like to thank Vanessa Thomas Smith for sharing her artistic dancing talent with us. Thank you to our young participants, Isabella Hansen, for that inspiring poem, and Josiah Yadam for his gift of music. Isabella and Josiah, you are our future, and we look forward to hearing good things from you as you continue your journey. And I don't want to forget the person that made this all happen, our videographer and director, Quentin Hayward. We could not have done this without you. That's Quentin Hayward from Inverted Lens Videography. You're the best, my friend. Let me say that Juneteenth shall always be celebrated because we must never forget from where we have come to truly appreciate all of our achievements of today and tomorrow. Now for our closing prayer from the very Reverend Canon Martini Shaw, 17th rector of the historic African Episcopal Church of St. Thomas, located in Philadelphia, founded in 1792 and home of Absalom Jones. Father Shaw has been at St. Thomas for 18 years and has led the growth of the church, which is now over 1,000 active members, the largest Black Episcopal church in the U.S. Father Shaw is a native of Detroit, Michigan, and came to Philadelphia by way of Chicago. His schooling includes both psychology and biology degrees, a master's in divinity, and coursework for the doctors of ministry at the University of Oxford in England. He is very active in the Episcopal Diocese, as well as being a former national vice president for the Union of Black Episcopalians. Father Shaw serves on several local and national boards, including the Lankenau Medical Center in Philadelphia, the Philadelphia Bar Association Commission on Judicial Retention and Selection, and our very own African American Museum in Philadelphia. If that's not enough, he even ran for the Illinois Senate. So, without further delay, here's Father Shaw.
My dear sisters of the Montgomery County Chapter of the Links Incorporated and other chapters around the world, I greet you and bless you as the 17th rector of the historic African Episcopal Church of St. Thomas in Philadelphia, founded in 1792 as the first Black Episcopal Church in the United States. Also, the church of one of your esteemed co-founders, Margaret Josephine Hawkins. May her soul and the soul of co-founder Sarah Strickland Scott continue to rest in peace and rise in glory, and may their legacies live on forever. I greet and bless you today as our nation observes Juneteenth, a time when we celebrate the emancipation of those who had been enslaved in the United States. I greet you and bless you today as extraordinary women of one of the nation's oldest and largest volunteer service organizations, committed to enriching and sustaining and ensuring the cultural and economic survival of African Americans and other persons of African descent. I greet and bless you today as you continue to embrace the future of our youth. May your core values of friendship, integrity, honesty, commitment, courage, confidentiality, responsibility, accountability, legacy, family relationships, and respect for self and others continue to serve and empower. And may Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and Holy Spirit bless our nation, our communities, our youth, and the extraordinary women of the Links Incorporated, who are indeed linked in friendship and connected in service. Amen. And God bless you.
Shoulder up on my cross, I'm gonna take